and has impeccable record with the community. Now this one says, I cannot endorse the consumption of alcohol from my congregation, for I am a Muslim faith, but I am in no way opposed to him being granted your support, which he was supplying for a license, an endorsement. Thank you for your kind, expeditious treatment for this application. Now this mosque is on 100, was on it. Now they're closed down. That's what happens when you go against what God wants. You get closed down. They had to be moved out. Now they're no longer there. And here we are now with a letter that came from them when we were right across the street from the people. Amy Roof's idea, the Carl's idea, was about food and restaurant and serving food germane to our culture. It was never about alcohol. He didn't seek alcohol when he was there. And all we're saying is let us continue in that corridor and respect it and leave it so it's alcohol free. Let us not, this doesn't affect their bottom line to that degree. I happen to have a good idea of how much money they make in that restaurant. I'm not chopping their money, but I want to tell you that. So it's not like people are going to be fired or going to lose people. So dear brothers and sisters, please, thank you very much. Here, let me give you back your glasses.
We have a couple of other speakers on this topic. I call them up: Michael Lofton, Barbara Butcher, and Laura Fora.
As a voting item. So it would be preferable. You've heard the point that we have your comments then, because we're gonna do it then, and that's what we're gonna need to post. I would recommend. Yeah, but
this is the arrangement. Let's go.
Listen. We're gonna deal with this issue during.
Last month we didn't get to all the comments from the
We're going to get to the comments this month, but we want to get through people who have community announcements. This is the announcement section, not the litigating of the liquor license.
I would like to suggest
that we should have done that before the conversation began.
Well, we didn't. So it's
fair enough. I wasn't aware that was happening. But we can't. It's not bias. We are smart enough to figure out what we think on this opinion.
I don't think that's going to be.
Kim Parker. Men's suit drive.
With Mary Moss.
In coordination with their housing committee.
That's what it says?
I'm going to put it like that.
Hi everyone, my name is Kim Parker. I'm on the Public Safety Committee for Community Board 10, along with our Chair Jason Clark. I was inspired to do a men's suit drive. As you remember, in November, we did a showing on the 13th about our prison population. And out of that, I got the inspiration to do a citywide men's suit drive. It began on January 17th, and it's gonna run until February 10th. So we have drop-off locations at Community Board 10, at 215 West 125th Street from Monday to Friday from 9 to 5, and on Wednesdays it's until 6:30 p.m. We'll be collecting gently used men's suits, dress shirts, shoes, ties, and pants for men, for workwear. The clothes are going to be donated to 100 Suits for 100 Men. It's an organization that's going to give the suits to men who are coming out of Rikers Island. Each month, there are 80 to 100 men being released from Rikers Island. The hope is that they will use the suits to go on job interviews and for work. I do have drop-off locations across the city as well in every borough. We have the Manhattan DA's office that is a partner with us, the Brooklyn DA's office, the Bronx DA's office, Brooklyn Borough President, Senator Jamal Bailey in the Bronx, Councilman Denise Miller in Queens, and we have a drop-off spot in Staten Island as well. So please drop off your gently used suits for the men's suit drive. And just one other point I wanted to make, that I'm an attorney and the executive director for the Metropolitan Black Bar Association. We're having an honor of Black History Month. We're gonna honor Congressman Charlie Rangel.
Oh God.
It's gonna be Thursday, February 16th, 6:30 p.m. at the Thurgood Marshall Courthouse in Lower Manhattan. Please join us.
All right. Next, we have Kareem Muhammad, Three Corner Resources. And after him, is it Laura Foran? Are you here, Laura?
Yeah.
All right, so can you, you're on this topic, right? So hold on a second. We'll do Kareem Muhammad, then we'll do Dr. K. Samuels, and then we'll do you. Okay? We're doing that order.
You just speak.
Is there Catherine Nixon here? I'm sorry. We're gonna do Brother Kareem, then we're gonna do Dr. K. Samuels, then we're gonna do Ms. Nixon, and then we'll do you.
Thank you. Peace and blessings, family. How's everyone doing? I'm Abdul Kareem Muhammad. I have the pleasure of representing Street Corner Resources and our CEO, Aisha Saiku. Thank you very much. As many of you know, we do anti-violence work here in Harlem. We have a team that's part of them are here tonight. These two young ladies are part of our team. They're handing out flyers, and we have some of the young men in the back. So we're glad to come before you. I want to introduce a young man who is the leader of our street team. He leads our team that goes out and builds relationships with young people in the street. He's a relatively new member of our team, but he has a lot of experience doing this work. His name is Arthur Durham.
Thank you all for having me. As Brother Green just said, we are an anti-gun violence organization called Street Corner Resources. We represent the vision and mission of Sister Aisha Saiku, who's an activist here in Harlem that a lot of y'all know. What we do at Street Corner Resources, we utilize the cure violence model, which is to go into the communities, identify, detect, and try to interrupt some of these violent conflicts that a lot of young people engage in Harlem that manifest in gun crime. And what we do, we take our credibility as messengers in the street. We have no guns and no badges and no bulletproof vests. We just use our compassion for a human condition that's been neglected far too long. And we try to bring out these young people who are engaging in these crimes, bring them to our office, and we cultivate them via job preparation, jobs that we have, like you just said about our anti-gun violence youth employment program funded by MACJ, which is the Mayor's Office of Criminal Justice, who funds our program, just like the City Council Office who funds Street Corner Resources. We go into the community, we bring these young people out, we cultivate them. We readily available have tangible things like mentor programs, educational opportunities with wraparound services, things of that nature. And currently, we have a 96-day no shooting incidents in our catchment area, which stretches from 137 to 146. So we can't do none of this work without the support and the continued participation of the community, because this is a hard work, but this is a necessary work that we currently engage in. So Street Corner Resources, where we speak peace forward. We would like to have anybody who's interested in maybe job opportunities at our office. We have an open house scheduled for February the 8th, which is next Wednesday, from 4 to 7 p.m. Everyone's welcome. Bring the resume, learn about the program, and maybe become part of our team.
Thank you. K. Samuels? And then Ms. Nixon. And then... Okay. Excuse me? We can bring the mic to you, Ms. Nixon.
Really, it should go up.
Good evening, community.
Good evening, Dr.
A couple of things I wanted to
cover.
The first thing is that there seems to be an agenda problem at Manhattan Community Board 10. Issues are raised at this meeting and they're not showing up on the agendas in the committee meetings, which basically means that information or issues that are being raised here is being ignored by the committees. This is compounded by the fact that there are no reports or no reports by the committees at each monthly community board meeting, so that you don't really get a sense of what's going on with the committees, because some of the minutes are a little confusing, or as in the case of the old transportation committee, even if you go, it's left off the minutes completely. So something needs to be done about this, and I'm tired of talking about issues up here and them not being addressed. I am concerned about the fact that Gail Brewer has not addressed many of these issues that I know she would not allow on the Upper West Side, shouldn't allow them in Harlem either. So something has to be done about this. for almost 14 years, I have talked about that library in North Harlem. I would love to know on how many agendas at the Library and Education Committee it has appeared on. I talked about it last month. However, it was not covered in committee, and I understand the person that should have brought it to the chairperson did not do so. This is a continuous problem, which means that issues are not being addressed. I can say that with the Housing Committee, if something is raised in this meeting, somehow it'll be talked about in that committee. And that's the way it's supposed to be. So that's an indication of leadership overall for this board and should be discussed at the Executive Committee, which I will try to attend to see whether or not it will be discussed. The other issue is, I heard the sister talk earlier about the elders being put out of their apartments. It's been happening for years, and your elected officials are well aware of it. But we need an independent housing association where people aren't running back and telling the elected officials every little thing you're doing in the meeting. So if that sister wants to start one, I'm down for going for that. Because Harlem does not have that. The other communities do. The other issue is this. I've talked about a reentry committee time and time again. People want to talk about giving out suits to go get a job. You know, that's nice. Not against it, but I got some problems with the fact that there is no reentry committee addressing that issue. I have talked about that for almost 10 years. And when Liz was alive, she talked about it. This is an issue that this board, knowing it has a problem in our streets, has ignored over and over again. Now I begin to wonder if people actually can hear. Maybe if I talk louder, the leadership will do something about it. It's like you don't hear. Why don't we have a reentry committee? This other illegal committee that you all have created cannot address reentry. Reentry should not be addressed in there. It will not be addressed adequately. I don't care how many suits you buy these brothers and sisters. Get it together. You say you're doing leadership in the community, get it together and lead. And now back to my comma boys. Brothers and sisters, I would like for you all to read an article, and I have, of course, a copy for the housing chair and the sister that's working with him on the 197A. It's called Gentrification and Displacement in Harlem, How the Harlem Community Lost Its Voice and Route to Progress. Now, it was too many pages for me to copy, so I'm going to tell you where to get it. Go to humanityandaction.org. The folks who wrote it was Marie Geril, G-E-R-R-I-L-D, Sharon Obialo, forgive me if I'm mispronouncing, O-B-I-A-L-O, and Nienke Venema, N-I-E-N-K-E, V-E-N-E-M-A. I think that's something that you need to look at. And one of the other issues I wanted to touch upon, which has caused a lot of homelessness in Harlem, is succession and NYCHA. This board has also ignored this problem. I brought it to the politicians who said they wrote some half-baked law or something they were going to do to deal with this. It never happened. And then they want to know why they're not elected. Okay, so I will be handing this out for people to get some information on this. And this is something that this board and hopefully in the executive committee will be discussed. And I gave the information to the sister from the public advocate's office. Anybody who wants another copy of what happened at the library with Inez Dickens, I have copies of that, and you can also go to DNA Info and just put McCombs in, and you'll find that information. God bless the Village of Harlem. Good night.
Ms. Dixon. And then...
I wanted to be in front of you. I didn't
want
to be on the side. I
want
to be in front of you.
Right. There you go.
Can y'all hear me?
Yes.
All right. Yeah, I'll need that. Wait, we all know this is Black History Month.
Every day.
This is also Dental Month. The reason I bring that up is because my committee is responsible for the dental program being in Harlem Hospital today. It is on record. Now you can look it up.
It's recording.
Also, the Patient Advisory Committee. The Patient Advisory Committee was there before the community of Board of Harlem Hospital was in session. When we had that, the community board of Harlem Hospital, the first board, I'm giving you history that is documented. The first community board of Harlem Hospital was elected by the people in the community. It was not selected by people.
All right, there you go.
So keep that in mind. And I also ask, why does the community board of Harlem Hospital get a stipend, and the community board 10, the community board of Manhattan don't get those stipends? They couldn't answer that. My other concern is, so much was said it threw me off, but I want to say this. I'm interested in education too, but listen, let me say this. Education means quality education.
That's right.
And I want our young people, they can be good in school, but when they come out on the street, they come out like they've been in a cage. They're running and kicking each other. So I want them to be gentlemen and ladies and gentlemen outside of school.
That's right.
Show your good training.
That's right.
Don't be kicking each other. They're running into each other, and oh my goodness, is this something? And I also want to say, why doesn't the community board have a senior citizen committee?
Amen.
I'm a senior. I'm 96 years old.
God bless you.
I'm glad to be wake up every day is a happy day for me.
Yes.
And I'm glad I'm in my right mind. Because
yes.
Some people are here but they don't know where they are.
Right.
When I die, I don't want y'all crying. I don't know why y'all crying. I'm the one dead.
I'm not dead about you.
I'm just concerned about the community. And when they brought them back that liquor, Lord have mercy.
Okay.
Liquor, the people is
poison in
drunk.
The community.
But also, you don't know that the people in the army, they got the place, what they call that where they go get stuff is cheap.
Commissary.
Well, they got the liquor there. So they got a problem when they're in the army, they get it, and when they come out, they're drunk. We really fight the battle. And I tell my children, don't argue with nobody. Now, I was blessed. I have three sons. I was really blessed. My oldest son is a retired policeman. My second son, he's one of the commissioners of the sanitation department. My third son would have been a fireman, but when so many people of color passed, this was during Dinkins' reign, so many people passed, that whoever was in charge of the test said it wasn't cheated, and so that test was null and void, so he wasn't a fireman. But anyway, he's prospered what he's doing now. But I'm just saying, Our children are the cream of the crop. That's why I'm trying to get respect. The boys, they're the cream of the crop. So if you got the cream of the crop, you really work for it. And you know, you used to see the, I'm giving you all the time, tell my own lady. You know the cream, you used to see the cream. Now you can't see the cream, but so they know it is that. But also, you know, you get a box of cornflakes. Look, it's camouflage. When you open up the box, half of the phone, half of it is air. So, you know, tell you nothing. You know, they, wait a minute, they gave us a dollar raise on the Social Security. A dollar now? A dollar. And they got three pages saying, if you want to contest, my time is worth more than a dollar. And look, let me tell you what they're doing. So now that they're going to give you the dollar,
your rate will go up a dollar.
When somebody found out, they going to take, because you're not going above the line to
your
get
your rent going to go up
so
a dollar.
They going to take $3 away from your food stamp. No, you're just in a mess.
God bless Ms. Nixon. God bless you, Ms. Nixon. Thank you for being a member of the Harlem community. All right. Good night.
Thank you, Ms. Nixon. That was a much needed change of energy. So I'm going to keep this to 2 minutes. I did want to respond to my neighbors who were up here earlier from the mosque. My name is Laura Forer. I have lived on 116th Street for nearly a decade now, and I know my neighbors feel that they represent the corridor. I'm here to represent the residents of 116th Street. And we, you know, we've seen Harlem change a lot in the past decade, and that hasn't happened because we've made it more difficult for business to succeed. You know, now you can walk down the street at night, and Harlem is full of active, socializing people, and a big reason for that. A big reason for that,
because of the liquor,
is that the Harlem restaurant scene is growing. So the ability for a restaurant to serve alcohol is often crucial to its success. And I know that at last month's meeting I was here, and there were a lot of comments about you can go out and you can have a good time without alcohol. And I totally agree with that. I actually rarely drink myself. However, if you ask any restaurateur in New York, he or she will tell you that restaurants that serve alcohol tend to be on more stable footing. And restaurants that are more likely to succeed and are therefore more successful make our neighborhood safer.
With alcohol.
So I know that there's a concern that allowing alcohol will open up the doors to slip back into unsafe territory of illegal drugs, of which alcohol is not, it is legal. And we can all agree that none of us want that to happen to Harlem, absolutely. So instead of filling the street with drugs, let's fill it with something else, like people socializing and filling the streets in a happy way. So if we look at the facts, I know that right now alternative facts are very popular based on emotion and opinion, but that doesn't make them facts. And there's actually no evidence to support that serving alcohol makes neighborhoods more dangerous. And there's no evidence of that. So people are not stumbling down our streets threatening our children, even though... Excuse me? I didn't interrupt you, Tori.
I'm not talking. What are you talking about?
Oh, sorry. I thought it was you. I'm sorry. Whoever it was, I didn't interrupt when they were up here. So the fact that alcohol is legal, and more importantly, that restaurants in Harlem, most of which do serve alcohol of some sort, contribute to the thriving, joyful neighborhood that Harlem is. And that's the current situation. That's how it should remain. So let's look at the real facts. And the facts are that restaurants that are able to serve alcohol are better set up for success. And successful restaurants make for safer neighborhoods. So we don't need to make it more difficult for institutions like Amy Ruth's and other places like that to succeed after all they've done to make the slave neighborhood lively and safe. Thank you.
Thank you. Right before we get into, before we transition, Aiken Felton from the Public Advocate's Office is here.
What's your name?
Laura.
Sometimes folks come and don't want us to be
here. Who are you representing?
Not alcohol in itself.
We'd love to hear from you, Ms. Felton, and your...
Makes me safer. Yes.
Who are you representing?
Myself. Okay, but why did you accuse this man of shouting out when he did?
I'm sorry, I thought I heard Tariq shout.
Yeah, he was very disrespectful.
I apologize to Tariq, and it didn't involve you. I apologize. Well, then don't interrupt when I'm talking up there.
Good evening, Harlem. How are you doing this evening? Hello.
Hi.
Hey, it's warm in here, but we're glad to be here, right? You guys look amazing. So, again, I'm Adrian Felton. I'm with Public Advocate Letitia James' office. And thank you. So on the back table, there is our newsletter of what we got going on. And we also have an event coming up, Harlem Talk to Tish. And that's where you come. You have dinner with us. You get to fill out this wonderful survey. Now, this survey is crucial. It actually gives hard data on what's going on here. Tangible information. Now, you don't have to put your name to it. But if, whether you live, work, go to school here in Harlem, it affects you. We really need you to come and fill that out. I know you're probably going to love the food, too. But we're really there so you can actually ask questions to the public advocate. We'll also have the health department, Department of Education, HPD, Sanitation, and NYPD on hand, because this is an opportunity for you guys to actually ask these questions to this leadership in these agencies with the public advocate there being the MC, because those were the agencies that we recognized that the Harlem community had the most issues with. So again, you have the RSVP because, again, it will be a catered event. If you look on the back of the flyer, you'll see my information. There is one catch here. Unfortunately, the venue, which is Harlem Hospital in the Pavilion, was only available on the first Wednesday of March.
Oh.
Sorry. But with it, from 6 to 9. So I don't want to not come here and tell you about it, and I don't want to rain on the parade of 10, but I have to do my duties. Because it's actually for all of Harlem. We pick Harlem Hospital because it's centralized. It's not too far east. It's not too far west. But it's important that you come. If you cannot come because you're here, send someone in your family. Send one of your friends. RSVP, because we want to make sure that you're heard and your voices are heard. So don't forget to go to the back and get one of our newsletters and to pick up the flyer. And the RSVP information is on the back. So thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thank you, Boyte.
Thank you. All right, Samia Canton from CEC5. Please, really quickly, given how important the Community Education Council is, we want to give you a minute or two, but please, we're running late. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Dr. Sanaya Bethlehem Canton. I'm the president of CEC5, which is Harlem's community board, school board. We are housed in PS 125 on 123rd Street between Morningside and 5th. And so as we look at this election, we have so many issues in education. For the last 2 years, we have been collecting data on our public schools and our charter schools here in this district and how they work together or not work together. And so part of our issue is we don't have enough of the community voice at the table. And so we recently launched a campaign called Wake Up to What Matters, where we did several events around issues around education. We had an event at the Schomburg last year, where we had a panel discussion on the state of education. And as you see all these great buildings come up in this community and our community become much more diverse, what is not happening is our schools. We're not building schools. The last time a school was built in the Harlem community was in the 1930s. When you look at the demographics and the data, the issues are the same as they were for our children in the 1920s as they are today in 2016, in terms of resources, in terms of lack of diverse programs. In Harlem, we either have charter schools or traditional public schools. When you look at District 1 and 2, you have something called Blue Ribbon Schools, Performing Arts Schools, Gifted and Talented Schools. And while charter schools are great, all children are not going to be selected to them. So we have to make sure that our public schools are still serving those kids who may not get chosen. So we're looking for parents and we're looking for people to come out to voice your opinion. We have committees that we would like you to share your expertise to help us work with the school system to make better schools and give us more resources. Our meetings are every second and third Thursday of the month at 6:30 at PS 125. So please come out and support our efforts. We currently have a campaign around the new Secretary of Education where we're trying to do some stuff to make sure that our schools don't begin to lose more funding. So if you have a voice, if you have ideas, we're looking for the support. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. We're going to transition into something that we started under the leadership of Dr. Cheryl Smith and Donna Gill, which is our Community Board 10th Service Award, for a brief presentation. Okay. Thank you.
Hello. Good afternoon.
Good evening.
We started the Community Service Award for members of the community that are outstanding.
Thank you.
We ask that the community provide names of people, because it can be anyone, and it doesn't have to be usual suspects who gets awards all the time. Today's award, this is our second awardee, and his name is Lauren Dilling. Please come up.
Thank you very much. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, board members and my fellow Harlemites. Well, some folks, they've always thought that I've always taken care of my boys. But when I do things for Harlem, I do it for everyone. And it has always been a pleasure to work for my people. I'm not a politician. I believe in fairness. I believe in equality. And if I don't see it in my community, I'm gonna yell. You guys probably have seen me in Cranes, in the New York Times, CBS. I'm not intimidating talking on behalf of my people. So that's why I'm here this evening. With gratitude, thank you.
Thank you.
What exactly was done?
Next.
What did you do?
Come to that. Next, first roll call by our secretary, Christina Curry.
John Lynch.